everyone, it's Justin again. In this lesson, we are going to further build our probability knowledge by learning how to solve permutations and combinations. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to determine the number of outcomes for scenarios using permutations and combinations. First, we'll use a scenario to help us understand what permutations are. Next, we'll alter that scenario to help us understand what combinations are. Finally, we'll complete two example problems to help us solidify our understanding. Here's a scenario for you to think about before we start talking about permutations and combinations. Let's say that Jack and Jill are at a convenience store. They're each going to buy a bag of chips to eat, and they want to each have a different kind of chip than the other. There are 5 bags of chips to choose from. Jill randomly selects her bag of chips first, and then Jack randomly selects from the remaining 4 options. How many different outcomes do you think could happen? You might be tempted to do this problem using the fundamental counting principle, and that would work, but we're going to need to use a tree diagram again later in this lesson, so let's try to set up a tree diagram for this. Jill has first choice, so she can choose between all 5 options. And Jack is choosing from whichever 4 options are left over. So this gives us 5 times 4, which is 20. This means that there are 20 ways that they could choose their chips from the 5 bags. Now that you have some background information, let's talk about our first topic for today, permutations. A permutation is the number of ways that a set can be arranged when the order matters. In the scenario we just looked at, Jill and Jack were going to each get a different bag. The bag chosen first went to Jill, and the bag chosen second went to Jack. So the order the bags of chips were chosen in mattered. For example, Jill getting bag A and Jack getting bag B is a different outcome than Jill getting bag B and Jack getting bag A. This is a permutation because the order matters. Back when we learned about the fundamental counting principle, we learned that if we wanted to order all 5 choices, it would look like this. This would be like if Jack and Jill had 3 more friends with them and they were all picking a bag of chips. But in this scenario, we only care about the first 2 choices, because it's only Jill choosing and then Jack choosing. Since we don't want all of this, how can we mathematically get rid of it? We can divide by it. Then the only factors that are left are the 5 and the 4. Now, how can we shorten this in a way that's easier to type into a calculator? Since we're multiplying a whole number times each whole number smaller than it, we can write this as 5 factorial over 3 factorial. How could we have gotten 5 and 3 from the original problem without going through all of this? Well, 5 is the number of options Jack and Jill had to choose from, and since they only chose 2, 5 minus 2 gives us 3 as the number of options they had left over. We can generalize this to create a formula that will work with any permutation. In this formula, P tells us that this is a permutation. N represents the number to select from, and R represents the number being selected. In our Jack and Jill scenario, the number they were able to select from was 5. And the number they were selecting was 2. Substituting in 5 for N and 2 for R takes us exactly where we wanted. So there we have it, the formula for permutations. You might be wondering what the point of all this is when we already knew that the Jack and Jill scenario was just 5 times 4. Well, what if you had a situation where there were 3,000 options and you needed to choose 100? And you cared about the order? Well, then that would be a mess to try to type into a calculator without using the formula. Plus, this formula is very closely related to the formula for combinations. which we're going to talk about right now. Let's use our Jack and Jill scenario again, but change things up a bit. This time, Jack and Jill are going to share the chips that they pick out. They'll randomly choose the first bag of chips together, and then randomly choose the second bag of chips together. Then when you go to eat the chips, they're going to share them. Any ideas on how that changes this tree diagram that we have from earlier? Well, for starters, this is no longer Jill's bag of chips, and this is no longer Jack's bag of chips, since they're sharing. So how does that affect these two branches of this tree diagram? These two branches would actually be the same outcome now, because it's the same two bag of chips for them to share, and the order they choose them in doesn't matter anymore. Let's get rid of one of these because there's no reason to count the same result twice. Do you see any more duplicates that we can get rid of since the order no longer matters? The same would be true here with chips A and C. We're showing this outcome twice, so let's get rid of one of them. Take some time now to go through this tree diagram and get rid of all the duplicates. You can choose to cross them off in your notes template if you want. Figure out how many results are remaining when the duplicates are gone. When I take away all the duplicates, we're only left with 10 possible outcomes. This is an example of a combination, because a combination is the number of ways that a set can be arranged when order doesn't matter. We were able to find out that when order didn't matter, Jack and Jill had 10 possible combinations of bags of chips, but we used a tree diagram to do that, which of course isn't very efficient. So we need to find a way to make this easier to calculate. With the fundamental counting principle, we can find all of the ways to arrange all 5 bags of chips and then divide out the extras to arrange only the 2 bags that Jack and Jill need. The only extra thing we need to do here is get rid of those duplicates. We do that by dividing out all of the ways that each group of chips can be arranged. Let's take a look at our permutation formula from earlier. We can turn this into a formula for combinations by dividing out those duplicates, which happens by adding r factorial to the denominator. We should also change this to a c for combinations. Notice that n and r have not changed. Go ahead and substitute 5 and 2 into this formula and verify that you get 10 as the answer. Pause the video now to work through this yourself. 5 factorial over 3 factorial times 2 factorial gives us the 10 possible ways that Jack and Jill could choose their bag of chips when the order doesn't matter. Now that we know all about permutations and combinations, let's try 2 more example problems. This problem says that there are 20 students in a classroom. The teacher is choosing 3 of them. The first will help with cutting paper, the second will help with gluing, and the third will clean the desks. In how many ways can the 3 students be chosen? Do you think that this problem can be solved using a permutation or a combination? This can be solved using a permutation because each student chosen has a different task to help with. Even though the students aren't being put in any order, they are completing different tasks based on who's chosen first, second, and third. Now that we've figured out this is a permutation, can you determine what numbers represent n and r so we can use the permutation formula? The number the teacher is selecting from is 20 students, and the number of students being selected is 3. Go ahead and substitute these values into the formula and calculate the answer. When substituting everything in, this is what we get, which is equivalent to 20 factorial over 17 factorial. When typing this into a calculator, we get 6,840 as the number of ways that the teacher could select the 3 students. Here's our final example. It says, there are 20 students in a classroom. The teacher is choosing three of them to help with the task. And how many ways can the three students be chosen? Should we use the permutation formula or the combination formula to solve this? Since the three students the teacher chooses will work on the same task together, it doesn't matter what order they're chosen in. And therefore, we should use the combination formula. See if you can use this formula to solve this problem and get an answer all by yourself. Pause the video now. Just like in the previous example, the number of students the teacher is selecting from is 20, and the number being selected is 3. When substituting these values into the formula, we get this. We can simplify this a little more before typing it into a calculator by changing 20 minus 3 to 17. And when we calculate our final answer, we get 1,140. When comparing this solution to what we had in the previous example, it makes sense that our answer would be quite a bit less, since we aren't counting different orders of the same three kids as different answers anymore. Now you know where the formulas for permutations and combinations come from, and you're able to determine when it's appropriate to use each to solve for the number of possible outcomes in a scenario. Be sure to complete the activity in your PDF next. This is where you'll get to learn to use permutations and combinations to find probabilities. See you next time!